بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى: يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات. ونحن اليوم إن شاء الله في طلب للعلم من فضيلة الشيخ سيد حفظه الله سبحانه وتعالى، ومع موضوع تفسير للآية الكريمة من سورة الحجرات التي تبدأ من بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، وإن طائفتان من المؤمنين اقتتلوا فأصلحوا بينهما. فضيلة الشيخ، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته، أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا.
أهلا بكم فضيلة الشيخ. الأسبوع الماضي بدأتم، الأسبوع الماضي والذي قبله كما أعتقد، بدأتم بتفسير هذه السورة، سورة الحجرات، وأنتم اليوم وصلتم إلى هذه الآية الكريمة التي تبدأ: وإن طائفتان من المؤمنين اقتتلوا فأصلحوا بينهما. بداية، كما يبدو أن المؤمنين قد يقتتلوا، ما هو حكم الشرع في المؤمنين؟ ومتى يكون المؤمن، ومتى للإنسان أن يخرج عن الإيمان، ومتى يكون لا يزال مؤمنا؟ تفضل يا شيخ.
بسم الله، والحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على مصطفى رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع هداه، وبعد، جزاكم الله خيرا أخي عثمان على عن هذه الأسئلة وعن هذه المقدمة. I just like to be in English as well, both Arabic and English.
إن شاء الله.
So in general, we started تفسير and I chose سورة الحجرات, and الحجرات means the rooms of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And it was very humble and very simple rooms, and it was a very simple accommodation for his wives. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was in his rooms, and someone called him from behind, and then Allah sent down this verse in this surah, telling that those who call the Prophet from behind the rooms do not have any sense. And the surah in general is 18 verses. And it's telling Muslims how to behave themselves with Allah, how to behave themselves with the Messenger of Allah, how to behave themselves with the Muslims, and how to behave themselves with people in general. Now we are up to this verse number 9, which says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قَتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. So it means, and if two parties among the believers fall to fighting, then make peace between them. Make peace between them. So this verse is telling us how the Muslims are viewed by Islam. First, they are human. They are not angels. They are not ma'soom. They are not infallible. They can make mistakes. They may have disputes. So disputes may arise among Muslims. And then this ayah is giving us a technique, a way. It makes it compulsory upon the Muslim community in general to settle down the dispute, reconcile the disputing people, and make peace. So this dispute can be so little, like sometimes calling each other by names. I'm not saying it's little, but it's still verbal. It's still in a lower level. And then it can develop into a very cruel and very harsh level, which is physical fighting. Allah said, if this happens, if two parties among the believers fall to fighting, then make peace between them. I like first to start with giving the occasion of revelation. Asbab al-Nuzul. Scholars here mentioned in this verse and the verse after, they mentioned so many occasions. And all of them could be true. One of them, قيل للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لو أتيت عبد الله بن أبي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was suggested to go visit Abdullah ibn Ubay. Abdullah ibn Ubay is the head of the hypocrites in Al-Madinah. Abdullah ibn Ubay, before the advent of Islam in Al-Madinah, before the arrival of the Prophet in Al-Madinah, he was nearly a king. So his people in Al-Madinah are Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, together are known as Al-Ansar. So people in Al-Madinah were preparing the crown for him to make him a king. And they have never agreed on any person before him to be a king on both of them. But this person, so he was nearly nominated a king. But suddenly, Islam came to being. Islam came to the scene. And people loved the Prophet ﷺ, and Islam got all the attention. And it changed a lot in the political scene in Al-Madinah. Now Abdullah ibn Ubay thought that the Prophet ﷺ is his main opponent, his rival, who took all power, all potentials from him. So he does not stop planning, plotting, talking in a bad manner about the Prophet ﷺ. Now the Prophet is suggested. How the Prophet ﷺ behaved with this man? The Prophet ﷺ was so kind with him. He understood that why he is doing this. And he is trying to create any trouble and is to split the ranks of the believers. And the Prophet ﷺ never gave him the chance. So what happened? One day the Prophet was requested to go see that man. So the Prophet rode his donkey and the Muslims went with him. They passed by Ardun Sabiha. Ardun Sabiha means like salinitary, like it has a lot, its soil has a lot of salt. So it would cause such a soil, would raise dust on the Muslims when they passed by it. Anyway, when they arrived in, or when they arrived into the, at this man, at their destination, he said to them, إليك عني فوالله لقد آذاني نتن حمارك. So Muslims went with the Prophet on the way. They had to walk over a piece of land affected with salinity. When the Prophet ﷺ approached him, he said, do not come near me. By Allah, the foul smell of your donkey has offended me. So when he said this to the Prophet ﷺ, a man from Al-Ansar, from his own people, said to him, Wallahi lahimaru rasulillahi atyabu rihan minka. By God, the smell of the donkey of the Messenger of Allah is better than your smell. At this point, غضب لعبدالله رجال من قومه. Some people also, from his like, I mean from Abdullah ibn Ubay like, they got angry as well. And then Sahaba got angry at them. And then the dispute started developing into a scuffle. They started hitting each other, fighting with the palm tree branches, hands, sandals, whatever they had, until Allah sent down this ayah. وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا. So some scholars quoted this occasion as the revelation, or the occasion of the revelation for this verse. And another, there are other also that a man from Al-Ansar, his name is Imran, he has a wife, she wanted to go visit her family. He locked her up in the upstairs. Then the woman could send a message to her family that my husband locked me up. So the wife's family came. And the husband's family came, they started disputing, fighting, until Allah, and this reached the Prophet ﷺ. And then this verse came down. Anyway, no matter how was the reason for the revelation, the verse is very clear that fighting, dispute may arise among Muslims. And Muslims, the other Muslims, should not stand by indifferent. They should take an action. So as a Muslim, When you know there is any fighting, there is any dispute between a Muslim and another Muslim, a husband and wife, actually, husband and wife, you should interfere only in a subtle way when you believe it is appropriate. Sometimes, when someone who is unwelcome interferes, that may create more troubles. So, now, back to the verse, this verse came down telling the Muslims, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ قَتَتَلُوا. If two groups, two parties of the believers fall to fighting, So the fighting may happen between a Muslim and a non-Muslim, a Muslim and a Muslim, another Muslim, two individuals, or two groups, two parties of the communities. Then the rest of the communities should do their best to make peace and reconcile in the reconciliation. So Allah said, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Your question, Brother Uthman, you said, can Muslims fight? And if they fight each other, is this considered, are they still considered Muslims? I say yes. And that is the belief of Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah means the majority of Muslims who followed the track of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And these are the mainstream of Muslims. They believe that مرتكب الكبيرة ليس بفاسق. The one who ليس بكافر عفوا. They believe, our belief is that the one who commits a major sin, he is not kafir, he is still a Muslim, all right? But he is considered fasiq until he repents. As I said earlier, we have some levels. Levels in terms of obedience and disobedience. If someone disobeys Allah and commits a major sin, he is still a mu'min. We cannot call him even fasiq. If someone commits a major sin, this one is called fasiq. Fasiq means disobedient, rebellious, someone who rebels against the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this includes those who commit adultery, theft, drink alcohol, and so on. So these are fasiq, but they are still mu'min. What about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who said, لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن ولا يشرب الخمر حين يشربها وهو مؤمن ولا يسرق السارق حين يسرق وهو مؤمن أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, the one who commits adultery, when he is committing adultery, he is not mu'min, he is not a believer. And when he drinks alcohol, he is not a believer. And when he steals, if he's a thief, then he is not a believer. So he is not, the meaning of this hadith is they are not believer at that moment when they commit the major sin, because they can never mix. Committing adultery and having iman together, then the cover of iman is off. That's how, if you had the cover of iman, you will not commit that major sin. But this iman is retrieved again. So it's still there, but at the moment when they commit these major sins, they are not mu'min.
فضلت الشيخ هلا كما ذكرت عندما يرتكب المؤمن الكبائر يعتبر فاسق، ولكن ألا يوجد شروط معينة هي تنطبق على الفاسق؟ كمثل لا غيبة على فاسق، أو الفاسق له، يعني هناك من العلماء من وضع له شروط خاصة، يعني كالغيبة، كالسماح بغيبته، أو يعني كالأمور يعني هيك، يعني مثل كما نذكر.
نعم. So Brother Osman is asking, if someone is judged as fasiq, some scholars said, or some believe, I like to put it this way, some believe that we can offend his honor, we can do backbiting and gossiping. I do not believe this is an accurate statement. Mm-hmm. And first of all, it is not up to every person to judge people that this is fasiq or not.
No.
Second, we have a distinction between those who commit major sins in secret and those who commit them in public.
بارك الله فيك شيخ، هذا أهم شيء شيخ، هو ليس لنا الحق بأن نحكم إن كان هذا الشخص فاسق أو لا.
So it is not ours.
بالضبط، وهذا مرض كبير نحن الآن فيه، إنه كثير من الناس يحكم أنه هذا فاسق، يقول لك هذا فاسق، أنا يحق لي وما يحق، وهذا
no.
الأمر.
No. He is still مؤمن.
نعم.
And he has still have the full right. And if Muslims are not allowed to offend the owner of a non-Muslim, so by greater reason, we are not allowed to offend the owner of a fasiq.
No.
Except if this fasiq is committing the sin in public, which is very rare situation. And in this case as well, Muslim, the Muslim ليس المسلم بالفاحش ولا البذيء. A Muslim is also is likely to protect his tongue from indecent words, from insulting and abusing others. Anyway, back to the main topic. I said the Prophet said he's not mu'min, and the majority of scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, they said that he is still mu'min. So where they got this from? What's their proof? The proof is this verse itself, when Allah said, and if two parties among the believers fall to fighting, then make peace between them both. So Allah called them believers before he tells us they will be fighting. Actually, fighting is one of the worst major sins. The worst major sins, because it could reach to the point of killing. Two persons fighting. Fighting could reach to murder. So Allah said they are still mu'min and you have to make peace. Actually, if someone kills someone, that's another story. And there are some other details. But in general, that is the rule. Al-Bukhari and other scholars relied on this hadith, on this verse, as evident that committing a sin, especially a major sin, does not nullify faith, no matter how major sin is. And this is in opposition to the creed of Khawarij. The Khawarij sect are these people who were very strict. Very strict. They beat everyone in the way they pray, the way they fast, the way they worship Allah. You wouldn't believe that you can compete with them. However, they have an infection in their minds. They believe once someone commits a sin, a major sin, he's not Muslim anymore. And they relied on the apparent meaning of some verses and some hadith. However, the scholars who are well established in knowledge, they are different. And they reconciled the different verses and the hadith together. They had another hadith as well as an evidence, I mean Al-Bukhari and others. Al-Bukhari narrated that Al-Hasan is the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Hasan said, Al-Bukhari said that a messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a speech on the minbar, while Al-Hasan ibn Ali, his grandchild, his grandson, was with him. So now the Prophet is on minbar, Al-Hasan, the boy, is with him on the minbar, and then the Prophet was repeatedly looking at Al-Hasan and then at the people. So he was looking at both of them, this and this. And then he said his statement, إِنَّ إِبْنِي هَذَا سَيِّدٌ وَلَعَلَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَنْ يُصْلِحَ بِهِ بَيْنَ فِئَتَيْنِ عَظِيمَتَيْنِ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. He said, verily this son of mine is Sayyid. What does Sayyid mean? Sayyid literally means, linguistically means master, a noble person. So my son of mine, he's a wise person. He'll be a great person, that's the meaning. He's a great person, he's a chief or a master. May Allah make peace between two great groups of Muslims through him. So now the Prophet ﷺ is predicting what happened from the year 35 of Hijrah until 41. And that year started by the killing of Uthman ibn Affan in year 35 of Hijrah. That was 24 years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some rebellious people rebelled against the third Khalifa Uthman. And they circled his house and they killed him. Now Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was the next Khalifa. Ali ibn Abi Talib, now he's trying to make peace in the torn apart land. And it was torn apart because of those hypocrites who entered into Islam to make corruption inside. So they lobbied against Uthman radiallahu anhu. Now Ali is the Khalifa. And Ali wanted to make justice, which is retribution. He's trying now to arrest all those people who killed Uthman, no matter how many they are, and then put them through court, and then the verdict should apply to them. And those people, they will never stay quiet until this happens. So they started creating more trouble and trouble. And this ended up that big factions of Muslims, the Muslims in Al-Iraq, Muslims of Iraq, and Muslims of Asham killing each other, fighting each other. They would be fighting each other, and then when there is janazah, they will pray janazah on the dead. And then when there is time of prayer, they'll pray behind. Like
كانت معركة صفين.
معركة نعم معركة صفين.
هذه كانت أول. This was the first time that two big groups of Muslims fight each other, right?
It happened before in Al Jamal as well, but Al Jamal was not like a big fighting. And it was. I do like to go to in details in these things. Yeah. We need to have some certain session to talk on detail. But now this is not the right time. Anyway. This continued for a while until those people agreed on one night to kill the leaders of both parties. Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, which is the Khalifa, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, also radiallahu anhu, who was the leader of the people of Hashem at that time. So they managed to assassinate. They thought if they can, I mean al-Khawarij means the rebellions. And those people came from the ranks, from the army of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Ali ibn Abi Talib, he was failed by his own followers. His own followers left him alone. And they created trouble to him more than the other side. And that is a historic fact, no doubt about it. So those people from his own followers, when they rebelled against him, he fought with them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that this happened so that we learn from the Sahaba a practical lesson. How Muslim ruler should deal with the rebellions, with the those people who rebel on the Muslim rule. So anyway, he fought with them, and then they had an agreement to kill both Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. So they managed to kill Ali, assassinate him when he was preparing himself for Fajr prayer, and they failed to kill Muawiyah. So the status quo remained as it is for 6 months. And actually, the people of Iraq, they gave them their word, al-bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance to al-Hassan, son of Ali, and the boy who was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a member, and the Prophet gave the prophecy about, that he will be able to make peace between two big groups of Muslims. So now it is his time to materialize, to make this prophecy happen. After 6 months, he conceded his right of khilafah, of rule and power, to his rival, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. May Allah be pleased with all of them. So he did it. And that's how the Prophet ﷺ described him in the prophecy earlier. And that's how we call him. I mean, that is another evidence that if two group of Muslims fight for a good reason, as long as they do not believe the other side, as long as they do not believe the other side is kafir, as long as they do not believe the other side is halal dam, it's permissible for them to kill them. Because even if Muslims fight with one another, other rules apply. That if someone of them, like, if they raised the white flag, say, like, they hands up, then no one should hurt them. No one is allowed to misappropriate or take as their money as halal, or their wives as captives, or their children to kill their children. So other rules apply. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called those people, both people, big parties of Muslims. Tens of thousands were killed in this fighting. However, they were called in the prophecy of the Prophet ﷺ. Both of them are Muslims. And actually, Muslim is less than mu'min. But it's still, Muslim means still Muslim. All right? Some of them will be mu'min, will be more than Muslim, and some will be Muslim. So the common factor is they are Muslims. So here, what if one of them... So what if we tried to make peace? One of them insisted, and used power against the others. So here, the powerful army should interfere.
Which says, فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى.
نعم. So that's the meaning of فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا. But if one of them outrages against the other, transgresses against the other, used physical power against the other. So, some people call those who make protests, do protests, they call them baghi. They call that outrage. Actually, this is a political fatwa. That is not outraging against the ruler. This is not rebellion. This is not rebellion. So their rebelliousness, they will be rebellious only if they used physical power against the ruler. And here, the ruler has the right to stop it, to put an end, according to the standards of justice, as will be mentioned. Allah Qid said, but if one of them outrages, and they will never be outraging against the other until they use physical power, then fight you all against the one that which outrages till it complies with Allah's command. Means, if there is any dispute, it should be settled according to the rules of Sharia, according to the commandments of Allah and the messengers, Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah said, فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. So all of you, all the community, should fight against the outraging, the transgressors, until their turn, they accept the ruling of Allah. And here we have the solidarity, the consolidation, mutual consolidation among all Muslims. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, أُنصُرْ أَخَاكَ ظَالِمًا أَوْ مَظْلُومًا. Help your brother, whether he is an oppressor or oppressed. So Anas radiallahu anhu, the narrator, said, I asked the Messenger of Allah, it's right that I help him if he is oppressed, but how should I help him if he is the oppressor? The Prophet said, تَمْنَعُهُ مِنَ الظُّلْمِ فَذَاكَ نَصْرُكَ إِيَّهِ. By preventing him from oppressing others, this is how you help him in this case. So helping brother who is in the case of oppression, who is oppressing others, is to hold him back and say to him, it is haram. All right? Sa'id ibn Jubayr also said that the tribes of Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, so he mentioned also some other reasons of the occasions of revelation.
What's the most common? هل يوجد هناك حالة هي الأصح أو لا?
Usually in the ilm of tafsir, they usually say the same verse may be sent down so many times for so different occasions.
Exactly. And also another thing is all these cases happened, regardless if the verse been revealed because of them or no. So
yes.
All of this it did happen.
Yeah. So Allah said here, the rest of the ayah, فَإِن فَأَتْ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقَسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Then if it complies, I mean, if the transgressors, if the evildoers, if they complied to the commandment of Allah, then you have no way to crack down on them. No. Let them go. Then make reconciliation between them justly. That is another condition. If you make peace between two people, two parties, you have to make it according to the standard of justice. You have to be just. You should never be biased against one of them. Do not favor in one of them. And to be just, you have to meet two conditions. First condition, the knowledge to pass a judgment in the case in front of you. So in the case before you, if this case in business transaction, you have to have much knowledge in business transaction according to Islam. Otherwise, you will never be just. That's a big problem. A lot of people, they give themselves the role of a judge when they are not. And that's why it is said, the judges are three types. Two of them in the hellfire and one type in Jannah. قَادٍ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَقَاضِيَانِ فِي النَّارِ. The one, the judge in the hellfire, the two judges or the two types of judges in the hellfire are, one of them does not know al-haq, does not know the truth. And so he will never meet it. And another one who knows the truth, but he judges opposite to it, contradictory to it. And the one who goes into Jannah is the only one who knows the truth, and he passes his judgment accordingly. And here Allah is giving in the end of the ayah say inna Allah yuhibbu al-muqsitin. Indeed Allah loves those who are just. Allah loves those who are just, who are the equitable. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith innal muqsitina fid dunya ala manabir min lu'lu' bayna yaday ar-rahman 'azza wa jall bima aqsatu fid dunya. The Prophet said verily those who are equitable in this life will be on podiums, minbar, podiums made of pearls before Ar-Rahman. That's an honor to them. The exalted and the most honored. On account of their fairness in this life. It's because of their fairness, justice in this life. An-Nasa'i collected this hadith, and that's why Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Allah loves those who are just. I just want to give one more comment here. Allah said in the beginning, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِن بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَى أَمْرِ اللَّهِ فَإِن فَاءَتْ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. So when they were fighting, Allah considered them so many. Plural, جمع. That's why he said, اقتتلوا, in the plural form. And when they were accepting peace, reconciliation, Allah said, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا.
SubhanAllah.
He considered them مثنى. So means the two groups will be the peace, the attempts to make peace will be successful only when every side is deciding to make peace and accepting peace. And last ayah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةَ. That is the conclusion of the lesson of today. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةَ. The believers are but brotherhood. Means they can never be anything other than brothers and sisters. They can never be enemies. They can never hate each other. So Allah said the believers are but a brotherhood. Means all of them are brothers in Islam. The Prophet said in the hadith, المسلم أخو المسلم لا يظلمه ولا يسلمه. The Muslim is a brother of the Muslim. He is not unjust with him, nor does he forsake him. So as a Muslim, you should make sure that you never inflict any injustice or any oppression on the Muslims. And you should, if they are a victim of any oppression, you should never leave them alone. And the Prophet said, وَاللَّهُ فِي عَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ. Allah will always help the servant as long as the servant helps his brother. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا دَعَ الْمُسْلِمُ لِأَخِيهِ بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ قَالَ الْمَلَكُ آمِينَ وَلَكَ بِمِثْلِهِ. If the Muslim invokes Allah for the benefit of his absent brother, the angel says afterwards, Ameen, and for you the same. And the Prophet said in the hadith, مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي تَوَادِّهِمْ وَتَرَاحُمِهِمْ وَتَوَاصُولِهِمْ كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ إِذَا اشْتَكَى مِنْهُ عُضْوٌ تَدَاعَى لَهُ سَائِرُ الْأَعْضَاءِ بِالْحُمَّى وَالسَّهَرِ. The parable, the example of the believers, in relation to the kindness, mercy, and compassion they have for each other, is that of the body. When an organ of it falls ill, the rest of the body responds with fever and sleeplessness. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Al-mu'minu lil-mu'mini kal-bunyan yashuddu ba'dahu ba'dahu." A believer to another believer is like a building whose different parts enforce each other. The Prophet then clasped his hands. So that's how a Muslim should be to the other Muslim. Clasped his hands with the fingers interlaced. Allah said, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ. Make reconciliation between your brothers. Refers to the two groups that fight each other. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. And fear Allah in all of your affairs. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. That you may receive Allah's mercy. And this is a promise from Allah that He will grant mercy to those who fear and obey Him. So that is the lesson of today.
Barakallah.
Inshallah, we continue next Monday with ayah number 11 and so on.
إن شاء الله جزاكم الله خير ونفع الله بكم.
بارك الله فيكم.
بارك الله بكم جميعا إخواننا، وجعلنا الله وإياكم إن شاء الله من المقاصطين. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
بارك الله فيك يا شيخ، طولت شوي.